Hello, my name is Horst JENS. I'm very happy to be here, and I'm very happy that I got this running. I have here the same pictures on my laptop. It's the first time in my life, I think, that this worked at first try. So I teach Python to children. I do this since 11 years now. I'm self-employed. I do that as afternoon private education, like you do piano lesson or music schooling. This talk is about my experience doing that. First, I want to ask if there's a target audience for my talk in this room. I made this talk for people who have their own children or have their own computer club or the neighborhood coding teaching. Wow, okay, so this talk is only for you guys. But I'm happy that other people are still there. Yeah, I will say most of you know possibly much more about Python coding than I do. So it's not so much about code examples or coding, it's more about my experience with teaching. I was born 1970 in Vienna, and the most cool thing to do as a child was going in the fun park of Vienna, the Prater. It has this big Ferris wheel, and at my time it had also had a lot of arcade halls that were dark halls with shady people inside, and then these machines where you put in coins and you can play a video game for a very short time. That was the best thing I, as a boy, that could happen to me, to watch a player or to even play it yourself, and you could drive a tank or shoot at people or drive a very fast car. In normal life, with 10 years, you was not even allowed to drive, so it was very fascinating. And then in the mid-80s came the Commodore 64, I got one, and with that it was possible to play some of these games at home, not so in a good resolution, but still very fascinating. And of course I wanted my own games, so I tried to learn code. And there were two ways with the Commodore 64. One was to learn BASIC, and another one was to learn assembler. I managed to learn BASIC, but the games you could do with BASIC were not so fascinating. I remember doing board games, as a conversion of a board game in BASIC, and I never really managed to learn assembler because for my 12-year-old being, it was a bit too hard. Okay, and then fast forward to 2006. In 2006, I had a boring job as a database programmer doing Microsoft Visual Basic applications, I think. And I was looking for a good scripting language. I found Python in the internet. I learned it in one afternoon, and I was instantly in love with this language. That was so cool. Everything was easy. Opening a file was extremely easy. And then, to my delight, I also discovered there's a third-party module called PyGame. This is a port of an older graphic library called STL. And it makes possible with Python to code little games with graphic and sound and joystick and everything you need. So I could recreate the games of my childhood, and I was extremely fascinated. The first thing I did was, just for fun, I made my first game. There was an example game, I modified it, and I made a game where you steer a little penguin and he has to shoot rectangular enemies. And there's a circle of goodies and he can pick them up. And yeah, and a lot of little sprites, so bubbles come out of his ass, and little missiles floating around, and I had my fun doing it, and I was very proud, and I made a high score list where you record how many lifetime you wasted playing this game, and also I made a goodie which is like a weed symbol, and if you pick it up, then the shoots become irregular and then move randomly around and hit sometimes yourself. And there's a little green indicator at the top who count the time, how long you're in this stoned mode. So I found this extremely funny. And then, as something very cool happened. I put this game on the internet. It was my first open source project that I actually uploaded and cared about. And then I discovered, to my delight, that there were people who maintain websites for open source games, and they were discussing my game. And one of them, I think it was an American, was saying, "What an outrage, how can you make a game where a hemp symbol is a goodie to pick up?" And then another guy, I don't know his nationality, wrote, "You're a jerk." And I was extremely fascinated that someone is discussing my game in the internet in another country, and someone is defending my art against the unjust criticizer. And also there was a Japanese guy who had a Japanese website for open source games, and he wrote some translated text about my game in Japanese. And then I wrote him what you wrote, and he told me, yes, I made this translation. So I was extremely proud that someone in Japan was taking his free time to write about my game. So it was woo. And I decided, well, that is so much more fun than Microsoft Visual Basic for Applications. I will become a book author. At this time, 2006, there was no real book about Pygame, and I started to write my own book. Because I think, yeah, then I can make these games, and I will become ultra-rich and just making things that I like, and the money will come in, and I will just make games. And I really did. I have the Python game book, and I made examples, and it was basically my own notes-taking as I was learning how to navigate this library. So how, when I run into a problem, like how to rotate a sprite, I researched it, and then I tried to document it, and that was basically the game. Today it is still online, it's a doku wiki, but it's not in a good state because I have to redo everything because it was not very Pythonic, and also I'm now much more clever about how to use and how to teach, so it's not very good at the moment. It's still, it's waiting, laying around until I find time to really do it. One thing I discovered also as a wannabe author is I care a lot about free software, about open licenses, that you share knowledge. And I discovered that at least back in 2006, it was very hard to find publishers, book publishers, who understand the concept that if you put a code in the book, that this code is free licensed for everyone. So all the publishers I spoke with told me, yeah, you know, this is our book, it is owned by us, this is our intellectual property. And also the other authors I know in Vienna, some book authors from also from Python books, and they told me, yes, you can use my code, it's no problem, but don't tell my publisher because he owns it. So, and I think, well, this is a very silly business where all the business model is based on restriction of access to information. So I decided I want to have nothing to do with them. And the only guy I found out by researching is Richard Stallman. He managed to convince the publisher of his own biography that they sell the book, but still put the full content of the book under free documentation license. You can actually read about that in the second book or in the first book in the end note. But, I'm not him, so I think I would not be able to convince that. And then, yes, I was stuck with a book that was not very finished, and I already had left my job. I visited my first Python conference in Geneva, 2006 in Switzerland. I spoke with Guido van Rossum. I asked him, hey, can you write a page, introduction page for my book? And he said, yes, of course. And so that was extremely cool for me. But I discovered this is not a good way to make money. And so I reverted to that, what I always did for making money as a student. I was giving teaching as a training for adults, usually train for Microsoft Office or Visual Basic. And I did that, but this time I also did that with little children, first by accident, and then I won a national competition. And I think, wow, that's actually far more fun to teach children than to teach adults. And I become a Python teacher. And I don't teach Python exclusively. Here are some honorable mentions of other things that I found useful, especially if I go into schools and have a workshop. So where you have only a very limited time, like a day or a half day or only 2 hours. And I found that Scratch, it's a visual programming language, is very useful to just get some coding done with kids. Problem is, at the moment, it's based on Flash, Adobe Flash, so you need a browser where every browser has Flash correctly installed. Also very useful is BeetleBlocks. It's a bit like Scratch. It's a visual programming environment, but in three dimensions, so you can make a 3D. Basically, it's a 3D turtle graphic, and it has this extremely cool feature that you can save what you coded, and the saved file can you put directly to a 3D printer. So you can make children design their own trinkets or own pieces of hardware. Also, I try to get more involved with Godot Engine. It's a South American game library that got open sourced. And it is not running with Python. So it has its own scripting language that is not exactly Python, but it is very Pythonic. So if you look at it, you instantly understand it. And it has the feature to create 2D and 3D games, but it's still open source. Also nice to have is if you have children who own an Android phone or Android tablet. You can use Pocket Code. It's an open source lab. It's also for visual coding. You swipe blocks of code around, and this allows children to use to create their own apps very, very quickly. It's a very cool project. The guys also from Austria who invented it, very, very nice people. And generally, there are a lot of people experimenting with JavaScript, reasoning that in most school environments, there is already a web browser installed. The web browser usually runs JavaScript. So even if you're offline, you can do certain things with JavaScript also for game programming. I'm not fully, I have not so much experience with JavaScript for teaching, but I know that this is gaining more and more popularity, and I will try to get more involved into this direction. What I do and what I have good experience with is using Python 3 and the follow modules. The first is Turtle. Turtle is inbuilt into Python. It's a good documentation, a great way to teach children to use the Python or to make use out of the Python documentation. With Turtle, you can make logo-like graphics. You just need to open your terminal or IDLE and say import Turtle, and then you can create drawings. Another thing I love very much is a third-party module. It's called EasyGuy. It's how should I say, it's an easy way to use Ticker-Inter GUIs. With that, you can make little message boxes, and the message box can contain a graphic. So without any classes and without any object orientation, you can in one line make a GUI that looks somehow like a real program. And you can do procedural programming with that. Then I love Pygame, most, not because it's so good, but because I have most knowledge and most experience with it. I wish there would be a more modern version of Pygame, something that was also advised, I think, in the Python. Game engine. You can make games. There is also a very good tutorial on the web from Richard Jones about a Flappy Bird tutorial game made with Kiwi. I must say that Kiwi is not a Blender. It's open source 3D software. Originally, it was a video editing software. And the cool thing about Blender is you can make all kind of 3D stuff. It has a game engine shipped inside Blender, which is extremely cool. And it has Python shipped inside Blender. So you can script your own 3D objects with Python. So once you start teaching Python, you can then very easily go to Blender or the other way around. There are also tutorials around for Blender and learning Python directly with Blender. One thing I discovered is useful to work with schools is FreeCAD. It's a CAD software written in Python, I think. And the cool thing is if you're a geometry teacher or you want to create 2D or 3D printings, you can either draw them like with Paint, with a drawing program, and the program automatically generates Python code. Or you can do it the other way around. You code like make circle or make line, and then you see it drawing. So you can do both ways. And it has, if I'm correct, also an output for a 3D printer. So it's a bit easier to learn than Blender, but also very powerful. Those are the tools of the trade that I have made positive experience with. But please, this is not an exclusive list. There are tons of other libraries out there and tons of other things. So here you see one student of mine doing some turtle graphic. As you can see, we made a loop where he made rectangulars with different colors. And then the, each time in the iteration, the rect got bigger. And you can see he's very proud of himself. Yeah, that's more turtle graphics. The thing about turtle graphic is that what I discovered, it is possible that you make games with it, but it becomes boring very quickly. So if you're not a mathematic or a geometry teacher, then the amount of fun you can squeeze out of normal kids age 10 to 15 is limited. It's good for some 2, 3, 4 hours, but then you should advance to another topic. This is the Easy Guy game. One of my students won a national computer art competition that we did. As you can see, he made a little graphic. I think he used Paint or GIMP for it. And then he put this one graphic inside a message box, and the message box can have several buttons on the lower end. And with that, you can make very easy adventure games like you're in a forest, where you should go next, left, right, backwards, and so on. So you can use procedural programming, and it still looks somehow good. It's very easy. Yeah, then Kiwi. Here we try to make a hangman game with Kiwi. It was possible, but it was with an older student, and I personally have no experience teaching Kiwi to young students. I think it's possible if you know exactly what you're doing, but I personally reserve it for older students who have a bit more experience, especially because there's a split between design and code. So maybe for students who already know HTML and CSS and can split that. Yeah, with Pygame, I mostly make little games like that, games that I love to play as a child. You see here a game where you have tiles and you can move the penguin across the tiles, and then you make a freer picture. Yeah, and these games can all be found on my GitHub page. And the thing is, I'm be able, if the students have some knowledge, and I have two kind of courses. One is that the students come once a week, like 2 hours a week, if you have guitar lessons. And another thing is, if there is a spring break or a holiday vacation, then the children come 5 days and three hours per day. And in such a week block, I can make such a little game with them if the students are not the first time here, if they have some basic schooling. So I love PyGame very much for this purpose. Another thing I invest a lot of time into it, is to promote free games. I partnered up with Free Software Foundation. They are very active guys in Vienna. So we made big poster and we go to Game City. This is an annual meeting about computer games in the townhouse of Vienna. And we tried to promote the idea that there exist free software games, because I think this is the most important tool to motivate and also to introduce young people to coding. That you say, look, you don't have to pay for games or be content with the free-to-play games that they exist. They're actually free software games, open source, free software, and you can take everything that you find in this game, being the graphic, being the music, being the code, and you can modify it, you can make your own game out of it, and the most valuable thing, like Zero AD, you can actually get involved, even if you're just 14 years old, and can try to do something useful and give this usefulness back to this project. So you work at a worldwide project where everyone can profit from. And I think this is for minor age people, also for young people, that they can participate in an adult project with other adults around the globe at a really cool project. This is something very, very cool. And sadly, it is not very well promoted. But such games exist. Another game here I love very much is Dungeon Crawl. It's an open source game, and of course I can use all the tiles, the graphical tiles, to make my own games with my students, which saves a lot of money and time, because we don't have to paint them ourselves. Okay, if I run into new students who never coded before, I usually just play around a bit with Idle. I hope you can read it here. Basically, we made a small oracle here where the endless loop, and sorry, it's a 10 loop only, and you can print a question also in the text console, like, does Thomas love me? And then the computer will answer yes or no. And little children have tons of fun with that. I find it a bit boring, but I learned that it's for them, it's not boring that the computer says answers their questions. So, okay. You see, I usually have groups of max 5 or 6 people, because I have 2 tables in my office, but one table is full with my own stuff and I don't want to clean it up. So I group all my students around the other table, and sometimes they bring their own laptops, sometimes they take my laptops. And then, yeah, we try coding as best as we can. I have sometimes girls that I'm very proud of, but sadly they are not more than 50%, and usually only in vacations, not during school times. Yes, the students come with masks because it was carnival. The more students, I don't even know why I have this picture. Okay, this is a fake picture. These are not students of mine. They were in my office, but as you can see, it's all girls. So it's this was a day of the city of Vienna called Daughters' Day, where daughters are encouraged to go to offices and look for a job. And so I got a lot of requests that girls can come and see one day how it is to work here. But none of them become students of mine. This is more a normal vacation course. You see one girl, four boys, having fun. Yes, also that. Okay. What I can say is, what I try to achieve if I teach coding, I have no academic training in coding. I'm a heating engineer I can calculate a cooling pipeline. So what I try is to let the children do something that they're proud of. Like you can see here, this little guy is very proud and completely ignoring his sister and his mother, but they are also proud of him. I think he created something with turtle graphic or so. And if I manage that he did something himself and some goal that he maybe did not even was aware that he had this, but then he managed it and to achieve this, then they're proud and then they also come again and again, because I'm paid by the hour. So if I teach in a bad way, I have no students and no money. These are also three students of mine. They made a game together. The middle guy had an art background, so it was a music game where you have to be in the rhythm and you steer these little triangles and shoot each other, but you have to do it to a beat of a music. That was important for them. And I think they send it to a national competition. I'm not aware if they won. I think they don't won. But anyway, you can see they're very proud that it was, after 1 week, playable. Okay. Sometimes I go into schools and make workshops for schools, usually to attract students from my private courses that actually never worked, but I still do it. The teachers are very happy because I teach there for free. Sometimes they try to collect money. And what I do is I try to build friendships with teachers that I like, that is always useful. And I try to look a bit how the teacher teach, because especially older teachers have much experience. And this was a teacher in Carinthia in the south of Austria. From him I learned two very useful things. One was, if you can see, some children here have tape on their mouth, because he has the problem that maybe every parent and every teacher has, that it's too noisy and he cannot teach in a meaningful way. In the computer lab, as it get noisy, he put out a big scissors and tape and said, "Who wanna tape?" And the children really lined up to get their mouth taped and then got back teaching. And then they tried to communicate, it was, the noise level was reduced, and they have some internal ranking system who managed to longest to have his lips closed. So I don't know what the award was for being the last man with closed lips, but the children clearly, as you can see here, enjoyed it, and it was more silent. Another cool thing that this teacher made is he recognized that it's very boring to sit all the day long and get taught. So he tried to move his kids as much as he can. He got to gyms and to these muscle building facilities and get machines like treadmills and get these machines as gifts in his school, so that the children in the break can train and move on them. And sometimes he even tried to teach them while they were making movements. And all of his children, I have videos of that, all of his children were able to juggle at least three balls simultaneously with age 12 or so. I'm age 47, I can't even juggle one ball. So this was extremely fascinating for me. And I think it's a good way to keep the children more peaceful. Yes, this is something that never fails. Here you can see two important lessons. The first is, I think you know that, how to multiply a string. The text is in German, it means I'm Vanessa, and then the second line is I'm the boss. And if the computer writes 100 times that you're the boss, this is a very big ego boost for a little child. what is more important is, and I learned that by accident, because once I was playing around with the colors of the terminal, and then the children said me, now we're hacking, and I did not understood it, until I got the message, if you do something with a green font on a black terminal, you're a hacker. And then you're cool, and then it's fascinating suddenly. So always, first thing, change the colors of the terminal, because then they're real hacking. Okay, second thing I learned, I have from FOSDEM, I think I bought one stuffed Python. And this Python is very popular and helps my children to code, especially if it rests on the head of a student. You see, this guy is extremely relaxed. The other one, less so, because me, the teacher, is doing something with him, but the other one get help from the stuffed snake. That's extremely important. Yeah, more stuffed snake pictures. Yeah, sometimes what I learned is to respect children, even if I don't understand them. So they have very short attention span, but also they're very flippy. One day this is important, and the next day something completely other is extremely important. So I learned to not make any lesson plans, because they don't survive contact with my students anyway. I try to be well prepared in a general sense and have experience. And one this student came to me and said, here's now a Raspberry Pi. And with his pocket money, he bought a little screen that he can attach to the Raspberry Pi. And then we managed to install Linux, because he wanted to have his own pocket Linux that runs on this Raspberry Pi with this little screen. I don't fully understood the purpose. You have a very small computer with a very small screen. But he was extremely happy that it worked. So what we did, we printed out the tutorial instructions from the internet and tried, and we managed it in 2 hours. So I made him happy. Of course, I think he did not learn coding, but maybe he learned something else. It was for him, this was the most important thing in the world, so I did that. Okay, as I said before, I try to get the children into, my students into doing real world adult stuff, like working with Git, like trying to participate on an open source project, mostly computer games. But also here I had a reporter from the National Austrian Radio, the lady, and she interviewed my student. And as you can clearly see, the 8-year-old was not very much interested in her questions. And he was playing his own game that he coded some minutes before. And she asked him something like, what is it that is so very fascinating with coding computer games? And he said, typing. This the little girl with the hat is another student of mine, and the other guy is Derek Breen, the author of Scratch for Kids. He's an American guy, very cool guy, and he was living at my place for some time. So my student interviewed him in English. It was her first interview with a famous author in English, and then we published it in the net. This was also not exactly a coding interview. His book was about coding, but for her it was extremely important, because now she was with age 15 or 14, she had her first interview published. So I try, if I can manage to give them experiences that are good for their career, that are adult stuff, and I try to show them, look, you can do something that other adults do. Yes, yeah, can you see that? There, one student of mine was trying to make a little spaceship, and it should fly a giant 8. And he had no clue about vector mathematics, so I made him calculate the points that the flight part is in a coordinate system. And then we managed it. You see here the little spaceship clearly flying an 8. And for him, that was extremely fascinating. Also, for me, that was kind of boring, and I could have shown him function where he made that quickly, but then he would have had no clue why this works. So I made it in a bit more complicated method, but a method that was corresponding to his level of mathematical understanding. Yeah. What I also learned is, even if lesson plans, at least for me, does not work, it pays to have good examples, like proto games where something works. Like in this proto game, you have tiles and you have sprites that fly around and they can shoot. And then it's very easy for the children to change the amount of bullets that come out of a penguin, or change their colors. So to give them something to do, even if they have very limited knowledge of coding, that at least some play field or sandbox that they can modify on their own, they have some very surprising ideas what to do with them. Yeah, summary is that don't copy my model of business, except you want your mom every day asking you, son, doesn't you think it's time now to get a real job? And it's, even you see here, I'm clearly, I think I'm more wise and old and experienced than my little students here, but they managed, each day I met them, they managed to ask some question I had not thought of ahead, so I had to very quickly find a solution to some problem or a question they made. So it's you have to be flexible. But sometimes I have groups like that, all students, all occupied, clearly all engaged. And if it works really very good, they learn a lot from each other. So I encourage you to have groups from at least three or four people. It's actually a bit harder from the logistic to teach bigger groups, but it's very much more rewarding because you have to teach less. The children teach each other, mostly passive. I don't fully understand how this concept works because I noted that every time I try to teach them some theory, they don't pay attention, they don't listen, they just make jokes. So I think it's in vain. But somehow, mostly if someone of the group understood something, he brags about it, he shows the others, and then they get more involved. So it's good if students have an environment where they can learn from each other. Yeah, that's all. I also want to close with a note of Linus Torvalds, the coder of the Linux kernel. I think he's a good coder, and in his biography, just for fun, he wrote that he remembers childhood memory that he was sitting on the knees of his grandfather and the grandfather coded and he was just looking or somehow participating or maybe typing and the grandfather told him what to type. And he wrote himself that he at this age, maybe 6 or 7, had clearly no idea what he was doing. But now he is one of the world famous coders. So I think there's a lot of social learning involved in teaching to code that is not very well recognized. So if you have role models, if you have other people who you see them coding, then it becomes something for you that you want to achieve also as a child. And I think that's important to create an environment, be it a programmer group or a hackerspace, where people can code and learn from each other. Thank you.
You teach in German-speaking country. Is there any problem with the software written in English?
There's a problem with people, students telling me they can't read documentation because it's in English. What they mean is they can't read documentation because it's written and reading is stressful for them. So at least if I take them age 10, they know enough English to understand if they really want. But reading itself is an effort. You must read, that's something they just learned, and then you must understand, so spell correctly what you read, and then you must think. And it's far more easy for them to just watch someone or watch a video. But I had French in school, I had no English until I was 16. I learned all my English through coding, so I don't buy this argument that it's just because it's English, it's difficult.
Do you focus attention only on graphics?
No, actually, I can show later something. I think you can have a lot of fun in text mode. A text mode is not boring, and I'm a bit wary of all these online courses and online new cool things where there's good graphics and 3D graphics to teach programming. I think you need good teachers and good ideas to teach coding, but not necessarily good graphics, so you can have you can make a roguelike with text mode, and this is fascinating enough.
Yes, and I think they wanted to know if you, for example, if you tried any BBC microcontroller or Arduino. Or
sometimes students bring that to me. For me, it's a problem. I must make classes to scale my business a bit, and for that, it's very hard to buy hardware, even if it's cheap hardware. If I'm not sure that I can do cool stuff with this hardware, I'm reluctant to buy hardware. So I only make this if the student already has the hardware and brings it to me.
And how old was your youngest pupil?
I think so usually I take them with 10 years when I'm sure they have finished elementary school. I think the youngest I took ever was 8 years. It was the one guy you have seen with the Arduino screen. he was very advanced of his age. Of course, every parents I meet are convinced that they're genius kids. With 3-year-old, they can code Python, and I should now do something because they sit at the computer playing Minecraft all the time and so on.
And you already showed us that you teach kids in groups. And do you prefer individual or group courses?
I prefer groups because I demand 12 euro per nose. So if I have a group, I'm more happy.
They are asking if you have any project here in Blender, made by you or your children.
At this computer, sadly not. I had students who were very good at animation, but they had, with video learning or with some other tutor, some prior knowledge, and they made a dragon who was looking like this Game of Drone dragons and was animated. And what I do with new students to Blender is we play around with the Blender 3D game engine. There are tutorials out there for that. But I have nothing to show at this computer, sorry.
Do you look for other teachers?
Yes, always.
And your students are preparing also home? Or it's only
I wish. No, I think in 10 years I'd never... I mean, I say, look, as a homework you could at least... finish painting these graphics, that you don't waste our time here with painting this sprite. But I don't remember that one people actually, a student come to me and say, look, I made the homework. I think it never happened to me.
And the last question on slide 2 is not question. It's thanks for a great speech. Good luck and keep up the good work. Thank you.